monster, why you smiling? What's going on, everybody? Thank you so much for tuning into the J-Mokopa podcast. If it's your first time listening, here is your extra mercy. If it's not your first time listening, hey, thank you so much for being loyal. So here is your extra mercy. So if you're listening to this on YouTube, on Spotify, on Apple Podcasts, or if you are live on Instagram right now listening to this, I need to just say thank you so much for tuning in. Secondly, I want to say there was a special shout out online on Instagram to the podcast from Letajo. Here is your extra immersive. Hey, if you are live right now, I want to see some fire emojis in the chat right now. Put some fire emojis in the chat or in a comment section. And for those who are listening on the podcast platforms, please leave a review and just rate the podcast, because it helps the podcast grow. I appreciate everyone who has made a review or who has rated the podcast on Spotify or on Apple Podcasts. It makes a lot of a difference. So we're not going to take too much time right now. Like I say, I keep trying to make the podcast short, but sometimes it gets a bit long. Longer than I thought. But today's message, I'm believing it's going to be very compact, concise, and to the point. And I'm praying it's going to bring a lot of impact to your life. Let's pray, and then we're going to get into it. Father, we come before you. I thank you for everyone who's listening, wherever they're listening from. God, I pray that this message would minister to them, that it would uplift them, encourage them to keep their eyes on you, even in times of crisis. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. And we all say amen. So this message I want to share with you is called When Crisis Strikes. And I'm saying this message in light of all that has been happening in South Africa in the past week. If you are not aware of this, or where maybe you may be listening to this, or I don't know when people will listen to this or watch this, but this is the week. It is the week of it's the 18th of July right now when this podcast is being released, the 18th of July. But the previous week, there were crisis strikes, protests around the country, and there was great chaos that was happening. It was covered around the world. And I'm speaking this message in light of that. So one thing we need to understand about crisis is generally, another way of saying crisis would be disorder, when things are no longer in order and it's messing everything up. What the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33, 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 33, we are speaking about when crisis strikes. We are speaking about our country, South Africa, but not just that, but even in your personal life. What do you do when crisis strikes? But one thing we need to know about 1 Corinthians 14, verse 33, it says, For God is not a God of disorder, but of peace, as in all congregations of the Lord's people. So the Bible is telling you that God is not a God of disorder. When you see disorder happen in your family, when we see disorder happening in our country, you must understand that that is not from God. You don't say, what is God doing? I don't understand what God is doing. When you see disorder, the Bible says God is not a God of disorder. So now, when you think about disorder, who should you be looking at? We see in the book of Genesis, chapter 1, verse 26 to 30. It says, then God said, let us make man in our own image, in our likeness, so that he may rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, over the livestock, and over all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them, man and female, he created them. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it, rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, and over every living creature that moves on the ground. Then Jesus said, I give you every seed bearing plant on the face of the earth, and every tree that has fruit and seed in it, they will be yours for food. And to all the beasts of the earth, and the birds in the sky, and the creatures on the living ground, everything that has to do that has the breath of life in it, I will give each plant of fruit to you. And it was so. So the Bible is saying that God had given everything in order. In the beginning of Genesis, the Bible says that it looked like there was turmoil. It looked like there was disorder. But when God came in, he brought order. And then what he says is to you and to me, to mankind, he says, keep the order. So now guess what? when there is no order on earth, the people who you should be looking at, who I should be looking at, is ourselves, is mankind, because the responsibility to keep order with what God has given to us, God gave us everything in order and said, keep order of it. So when there is no order, who is it, guys? It's us. So when you see disorder in the world, you must understand that this is the work of man and it's not the work of God. This is the work of us. This is what we have done, right? This is what we have done. But God says this. When there is disorder, there is a response that you must have. When crisis strikes, there is a response that God calls his people to have. We see this in this very famous passage, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 13 to 14. It says, when I shut up the heavens so there's no rain, or command locusts to devour the land and send plague among my people, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, pray, seek my face, turn from the wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I will heal their land. I want us to go through the 4 points, the 4 steps that God gives you when crisis strikes. Listen, I'm talking about when crisis hits your family, when crisis hits your relationships, when crisis hits your business, but even when crisis hits your country, God tells us there is a 4-step plan for crisis, all right? Number one, the Bible says this. It says we must humble ourselves. Now, this is not so much before crisis. This is what happens when crisis strikes. I'm not talking about what happens before the crisis. But unfortunately, when crisis hits your life, you can find yourself behaving in a way you should not be behaving. When crisis hits your life, you can find yourself doing the things that God has not called you to do. But the Bible says when crisis strikes, number one, he says, be humble. Why? Because many times when crisis hits you, it is pride that arises on the inside of you. And another way of saying pride is false humility. False humility. You will begin to detach yourself from the thing that's wrong. I want to say that again. When crisis generally hits your life, you will begin to detach yourself from the thing that's wrong and say that that is what's wrong, not me. That is the problem, not me. That thing is not working right, not me. But the Bible says, humble yourself. Don't be self-righteous. We see in the book of Luke chapter 18, verse 9 to 14. It says, Luke 18, verse 9 to 14, it says, to some who were confident in their own righteousness, they looked down on everyone else. Jesus told this parable. It said, two men went up to the temple to pray. One was a Pharisee and the other was a tax collector. So two people went up to pray. One was a Pharisee, one was a tax collector. The Pharisee stood by himself and prayed. He said, God, I thank you that I'm not like other people, robbers, evildoers, adulterers, or even this tax collector. I fast twice a week and I give 10th of what I get. I give my tithes. But the tax collector stood at a distance. He would not even look up to heaven, but he beat his breast and said, God, have mercy on me, a sinner. I tell you, Jesus says this, I tell you that this man, rather than the other one, went home justified before God. For all who exalt themselves will be humbled, and those who humble themselves will be exalted. The Bible says that when you humble yourself before God, he will lift you up. I want to say that to you in your time of crisis. Sometimes when crisis hits you, you can say, God, I thank you that I'm not like the person who hurt me. God, I thank you that I'm not like those people. God, I thank you that I'm not an evildoer. Guys, even in South Africa, when you were looking at the looters, when you were looking at the people who were doing all these things that we can all agree were wrong, you could find yourself saying, God, I thank you that I'm not like them. God, I thank you that I'm not behaving like that person. God, I thank you that I'm not a looter. But can you see the ways that you have been wrong yourself? Can you see that even in the way those people were looting, that there are some ways that you have a corruption on the inside of you? You have greed on the inside of you. You are not behaving right, correctly and rightly yourself in different ways. And you can say, oh God, I'm not like the looters. I'm not like them. But when crisis is hitting you, the Bible says, stop pointing fingers, stop blame shifting and begin to look at yourself. Because listen, you are either a part of the problem or you are a part of the solution. The book of Romans chapter 3 verse 25 to 27, it says, God presented Christ Romans 3 verse 25 to 27, God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness because in his forbearance he left sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Where then is boasting? It is excluded because of what law? The law that requires works? No, because of the law that requires faith. The Bible says Jesus is the reason that we are right. So it's not what you have done. Listen, the only thing that separates you from the looters who were looting in South Africa in the stores is the fact that Jesus is in your life. It's not about your actions. It's not about how you behave. It's not because you are different, but instead it's because Jesus is in your life. So you need to be humble and understand that as much as the looters, as much as people who hurt you, as much as criminals need God, you also need God. So humble yourself. That's the first thing that all believers need to do, is to say, you know what? We need God too. We are failing too. We are greedy too. We can be thieves too. We can be sinners too. So we need to humble ourselves before God and come before Him. When you humble yourself, listen, when you humble yourself, you are giving God an opportunity to show you His grace and to show you His power. When you humble yourself, you're giving God the opportunity. But when you feel you are fine, you see there's no need for you to change. When you feel that everything is okay with you, there's no need for you to change. When you think, when you've had a fight with your husband or with your wife or with someone you're dating or a friend of yours, when you are full of pride, you don't think you are the one who needs to change. You see, this is why God says that you must be humble, because when you are humble enough, you say, oh, I realize that I also need to change. And if you were to change, guys, the Bible is telling us that even our country, even the situation around you will change itself. The next thing the Bible says, if you will humble yourself, then it says, and pray. What is prayer? Prayer brings connection to God. Have you ever been so close to someone that you communicate with them so much that you can be standing on one side of a room, they're standing on another side of a room, and all you have to do is look at them and the both of you know exactly what you guys are thinking? Or if a friend of yours or someone who walks into the room, immediately when they walk into the room, you can tell what type of mood they're in. This is the type of connection God wants you to have with Him in prayer. God wants you to have that connection with Him, because when you do not pray, you create space for miscommunication. You see, in any relationship, communication is the key and foundation of that relationship, and your relationship with God, the key of it is your prayer life, communication. When there is no communication, there's space for miscommunication. Now, the Bible says God is not like man that he should lie. So the Bible is telling you God is not like a man. So the results of miscommunication with a man is different to the results of miscommunication with God. When you miscommunicate with a person, maybe you can miss the person. But when you have miscommunication with God, you miss opportunities. When there is miscommunication with man, you can have a misunderstanding. But when you have a miscommunication with God, you can miss your blessing. When you have a miscommunication with man, you can maybe miss their birthday. But when you have a miscommunication with God, you can miss your moment. Listen, guys, your prayer life is so important, because when you have miscommunication with your God, it is going to cost you, not just cost you, but cost your country, not just cost your country, but cost the people who you love. The Bible is calling you to pray when there is crisis. Yes, I know it's difficult. There is crisis in relationships, crisis in different places in your life. But the Bible says your response to crisis is to pray, so you can understand what God is saying. The book of James chapter 5 verse 13 to 16 says, is anyone among you in trouble? Let them pray. Is anyone happy? Let them sing songs of praise. Is anyone among you sick? Let them call the elders of the church to pray over them and anoint them with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer offered in faith will make the sick person well. The Lord will raise them up. If they have sinned, they will be forgiven. Therefore, confess your sins to one another and pray for each other that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. The only reason that you are righteous is not because of your actions, but because of what God has done in your life. But your prayer is effective. So the Bible says when there are moments of crisis, you need to pray. But also it brings out here that you must call elders of the church, call certain people who are over you to join you in prayer, because unfortunately, if you are pride, you see, remember the Bible starts with be humble. But if you have pride on the inside of you, you're not going to accept the help of the people who God has put in your life to help you. You're not going to accept the help, because sometimes the elders, your pastors, your leaders, your parents, your friends who are in your life who God has put to help you, they may say things to you that you may not like and you may want to reject it, but you have to be humble enough to receive it and even to receive their prayers by confessing this place of crisis in your life. Number three, what we see is the Bible says you must seek God's face. You must seek God's face. You know, one thing that many people will tell you is that you need to be self-aware. What I want to say to you is that God's people don't need to be so self-aware, then they need to be Christ aware. A lot of people are so self-aware. So you are aware of what you want. You are aware of what you want to do with your life. You are aware of your plans. But are you Christ aware? You see, God does not call you to be a better version of yourself. God calls you to be like Christ. And when we are Christ aware, we are aware of where we need to improve in our walk with God, so we be like him, because Christ is the one who brings the change in our life and brings change in communities and in the world. So the Bible says you must humble yourself, pray, seek God's face. Unfortunately, too many people are seeking your own face. You are seeking that your face is seen. You are seeking that your face is okay. You are seeking your own face's comfort. You are seeking your own face's adoration. The book of 2 Timothy chapter 3 verse 1 to 5, it says, but mark this, there will be troubled times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of good, treacherous, rash, conceited, loving pleasure rather than loving God, and says, having the form of godliness but denying its power, have nothing to do with these people. Can I tell you one thing? All those characteristics are of someone who is putting themselves on the throne of their lives. All these things that we are seeing is someone who is seeking their will. You will begin to see these fruits in your life. So the Bible says in your moments of crisis, it says you must seek the face of God. Seek what God wants to do. Ask yourself, what would God do in this situation? Like I said, don't seek your own will, but seek the face of God. What does God want to do? How would God respond to the crisis? How would Jesus respond when he is hurt? How would Jesus respond when his business went down? How would Jesus respond? Seek the face of God, because as we seek the face of God, we are seeing his character. But lastly, the Bible says that you must turn from your wickedness. Turn from your wickedness. Turn from your wickedness. It's not only the normal things that we think of wickedness, but sometimes it's wicked thoughts, wicked imaginations, wicked ways of treating people. Turn from your wickedness, and the Bible says God will forgive us and heal our nation. You see, now this is what we need to understand. The Bible tells us that you were called to establish order. People are called to establish order. So when we see crisis, we must not blame the crisis around us. We must look at ourselves. I want to say it again. Adam and Eve, when they were hit with crisis by their own doing, they blame shifted. But scripture is saying that you must look to yourself, because you are either the problem or you are the solution. You are either a part of the problem or you are a part of the solution. And the Bible is saying when there is crisis, the Bible says the church must look at themselves. Believers must look at themselves. When you have an argument with someone in your life, don't look at the other person. Look at yourself. It says that you must humble yourself, pray, you must seek God's face, and you must turn from your evil ways. I want to ask you, what have you begun to do that? And if you've not begun to do that, even in your personal life, then you'll not see the change. What God is saying through this is deal with ourselves first before we deal with the world around us. Let us deal. Come on. I'm closing this message right now. Let us deal with our own weaknesses and our own faults before we point out the faults in other people. Let us pray. Father, I come before you. I thank you so much for your word. I pray, my God, I thank you for your love and your mercy. I pray, Father, for everyone who's listening to me and listening to this podcast today. I pray, may this message have ministered to them. I pray, my God, may we take these four steps that you call us, how we should respond to crisis. And Father, we believe that as we respond to this crisis in our country, in our lives, and the things that we may be facing. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus, forgive our sins and heal our land, heal relationships, heal marriages, heal friendships, heal romantic relationships, my God, heal businesses and heal South Africa, Father. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray and we all said amen. Amen. Thank you so much for tuning in. That's the J. Mokopa podcast. Hey guys, remember that the Bible is saying we must look to ourselves before we see the change happening around us. If we want to see change, it has to start with us. That's the podcast. Please share it with somebody who you love, to your friends, to your family, and even the haters. Take care. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you're live on Instagram, I appreciate you. If it's on Apple Podcast, I appreciate you. YouTube, I appreciate you. Spotify, I appreciate you. I'm out. Take care.